See, you're reading Nietzsche.
I'm sorry?
Nietzsche.
I've just started.
I'm more of a Hegel man myself.
I wouldn't know.
What's your name?
Joseph. Or Joe.
Nice to meet you, Joseph. Don't worry, I'm not a homosexual. I'm just very tired.
Okay.
Bob, yeah, I'm here, yeah. No, no sign of her yet. I'll have a look for her now. Charlotte!
Well, that wasn't exactly comfortable.
Leave her in one piece.
Is it me, or is it just warm here?
No, I'm roasting too. Come on, we get on with it.
Oh, can we go and get a cold drink somewhere first?
Have you got any money?
No.
Me neither.
Scheiße.
So how are you finding it, Joseph?
It's a bit confusing, I suppose.
You'd love Hegel. He's so clear. A place for everything and everything in its place. He wants the world to run like clockwork. Not that he's overly rational, mind you. He loves how people dance, the back and forth of power.
I really want to know, you know.
I lecture on him, you know. Well, I used to, over at the academy. You'd love my lectures. It's such a joy to watch young men and women grasp the concept of the dialectic, to watch the pieces click together in their minds.
What did Hegel write about?
Freedom. Well, everything really. It was his history, though. That was what always interested me.
How come?
Well, so crucially important. For 600 years, philosophers were trying to make sense of his Geist. And then finally, it all came together. Finally, it all made sense. And I was there. I was the one they turned to.
What's Geist?
It's everything, my dear boy. Everything. It's how you know what and where, and how you came to be.
Like science?
No. Those bean counters just freeze the world and count its parts. Hegel saw the world in its dynamic movement. He saw its tracks, its footprints. He knew where we'd come from and where we're going. Moreover, he helped us realize that we're all connected in waves of tension, dialectics that unite us as tightly as a baby in the womb. And not just you and me, my friend, everyone and everything. By understanding Geist, we could finally read the world. Existence became a map for us to follow, from the chains of the past to the clear horizons of the future. That's why, without a good understanding of Hegel, time travel was always impossible.
Time travel.
But of course, how'd you know what to do? What buttons to push? What cards to draw? If you didn't recognize the interconnectivity of all things, how would I know to come here and sit with you?
What?
If it wasn't for the perspective given to me by free conveyance across the temporal plane, I could have completely missed this meeting. God knows what the terrible outcome of that would be.
Okay.
About it though. Look, if you want to eat something or you want to drink something, you need money. And we haven't got any. So let's get on with it.
Sir. Money like this?
For shock's sake, what are you doing? The spirit levels are already fluctuating dangerously, and you think it's funny to dip your toe in the time stream?
A toe in the time stream? Sometimes, Mohammed, I think you're a poet trapped in an oaf's body. Now hush, so I can buy us something dangerous to eat.
It's all about connectivity, you see. For centuries, philosophers argued over Hegel, whether this aspect made sense, whether it was logical, whether it was overly theological. And this is when it all got really interesting. Then they discovered gravitational resonance.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
Geist, my dear boy, Geist. For centuries, philosophers were worried about Hegel and his Geist. It practically destroyed the pursuit by splitting the world into those who sought answers in science and those who sought it in experience. Every being strikes a chord in the universal gravitational field. This resonates across the temporal waveform. By observing the contemporaneous tone, you can trace a harmony back to a single indexical. We could single out a single moment in space and time.
Right, so no robots then, no alien princesses. I tell you, you're starting to lose the audience here, buddy.
Once we combine the knowledge with the space folder used on any common interstellar craft, we knew that time travel, genuine time travel, was possible.
Really?
Yes. But of course, the question soon became, who could we tell? As I said, I worked at the Academy, and while we had a strong degree of autonomy, we still have to consider the Council of Four. Eli spoke so eloquently. The four most powerful men in existence, he led them like a piper of Hamelin.
Wait a sec, who's this Eli?
Oh, he was the leader of our group, the chief researcher, such a devout scientist. Sometimes when he spoke, it was like gospel. His charisma carried through the data, like rays of light illuminating the leaves of a tree. He saw it all so clearly. He said God spoke through him through science. He knew his telos was to master time travel. He was the greatest man I ever knew.
So, what are we going to do with you then?
Do what you like. Paid for the full hour.
Are you a nice boy? Gonna show me a good time? You're a smart boy. Gonna teach me some things. I think you need an education. Yeah. Your soul likes truth. I can offer you this truth. Campus.
Oh yeah? How you gonna do that then?
Very simply. Open your eyes and peek right through the doors of perception. But you need the key.
seriously.
Oh.
Jim Morrison lyrics.
Oh.
Worst serial killer ever.
It was Aldous Huxley. Bollocks.
Seriously, just pure chemicals.
They're absolutely atrocious. I shocking love them.
We're not on holidays, you know.
So that's your problem, no. You're round tighter than a drum. You want to learn to smell the roses a bit.
I don't know what I'm smelling, but it ain't roses.
Seriously, you have to learn to relax, you know. That's the difference between you and me. I mean, here we are. Stuck in the middle of nowhere, waiting around for someone who, by all accounts, would chop us into pieces so small that the goldfish wouldn't even bother chewing while eating us, and all you can think about was work, work, work. Well, I am sampling the rare delicacies that time has to offer. And you know what else? I look damn good while doing it.
I'm telling you, I'm putting in for a transfer. Maybe K-Line Corps. Conversation would be better.
Oh my god. These smell rank. I can't wait.
Listen, it's gonna be here any minute. You have to be ready, okay?
Ah! I'll be ready. I'm always ready.
Once we got approval for our first mission, Eli knew exactly what he needed to do. He was a devout follower of the Church of Miraculous Embodiment. For him, Jesus was the center of all creation, a divine entity embodied with all life's power and mystery. If he could meet him, see him, he knew he'd finally and truly understand all creation.
Look, look, I am enjoying a little, you know, fairy story here, but you know, I'm not in the mood, you know, to listen to some Dawkins God is for Tickos rant, nor am I going to sit here and be preached to about how I'm going to hell because I touch myself at night.
You touch yourself at night?
Oh, you know what I mean? I'm just sick of being bent over the head by God on both sides, you know?
Well, don't worry. I can't tell you about God. All I can tell you about is Jesus. Jesus did exist. I know this because I met him. And he's a very nice man.
Claire Stanley.
Yeah?
Has anyone tried to interfere with you recently?
Look, has anyone tried to kill you in about the last 10 minutes?
No.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Come on, this is a waste of time.
This is ridiculous. Hey, Bob. Yeah, I know, I never showed up. Right, we've got a new location. Send the picture out.
Just as Eli predicted, it was different, unique. But more than that, it was exemplary. It sang out like a symphony, echoing the background hum. And then we went for it. We traveled, and we met him. It took a long time, but eventually we found him. Yeshua ben Joseph. Eli was devastated. He was expecting a Superman, a Nietzschean Übermensch, some alien figure with superpowers. But all we met was a rather thin, poorly looking Jewish lad. Eli was sure there was more to him. He couldn't believe that he was just another man. So they spoke. Eli told them everything. He told them far too much. He told them our secret. The secret he swore never to tell.
What secret?
The method. The method we developed at the facility. We knew that time travel was possible. We had two approaches. With more research, we could have developed a second way. With more power, we could find a space, a rest within the Geist waveform, and fill that space with their own presence. The first way, a quicker and cheaper way, was to find a thin wave, a waveform that wouldn't last, one that could be easily overwritten without drastically altering the time stream.
What do you mean by overwritten?
It meant finding someone. Someone expendable. And replacing their spirit with their own.
What would happen to them?
They would die before their time. We'd have killed them. Eli told Yeshua this. He thought that if he could convince his savior of the importance of the first operation, that he would absolve him of the sin. He didn't. He just got up and left, saying that the blood we spilt was on his hands. In his name we had made him a sinner. He told Eli to leave and to never return.
So, Eli met God. And well, God basically told him to feck off. I mean, that's really gonna mess with you, isn't it?
I can't believe the half of it. Operation 1 completely changed him. He gave up caring about everything. And when he spoke, the charisma was gone. All that was left was a burning rage. He developed a tool. It meant that we could find weak waveforms from within the time stream. It essentially made the facility redundant. We could go back in time. Or jump to wherever we wished without ever returning. He made two, one for me and one for him, a parting gift between lovers.
I thought you said you weren't gay.
And that'll be the only lie I ever tell you.
Oh, I tell you, it's a good story. You should definitely write it down.
No, it's best not to leave any artifacts. Nothing can be traced archaeologically. We've killed all the people you see. Us too, on our various travels. We're wanted for all our crimes. Hundreds of acts of treason against the Council of Four. No, we can't write anything down. It's best to just tiptoe our way through history. Never making a scene, never staying too long.
That's grand now, all checked out. That's a legitimate 10th century Tang Dynasty, very rare plain red Ming vase. Should get you about, I'd say, 150,000 off some joker on eBay.
So, you don't actually know how much it's worth then?
Me? No, I just transferred here last week from bus licensing. We outsource all the valuing. Outsource a lot of bus licenses too.
So, what do you actually do then?
I like to think of it as selling dreams. I'm a dream salesman.
Okay.
You sure? Do you want a bag for that?
No, okay, I think I feel better with my hands on it, you know.
Just don't drop it, there'll be some serious ramifications on that.
Oh, yeah. More than my job's worth, eh?
Sure, probably.
Okay. Here, Gaston, give us a shot in your BMX, what?
Yeah, we need a trace and a jump. Yeah, he gave us a slap.
Far away in foreign fields, young men lie and wonder. All a while comes tapping from the German's rain, while I sit upon my rock here and ponder. The cause of life, its answer pain, but to a new dawn, I forever shall bear this flame. Yes, I forever shall bear this flame.
Months have been the most hip, most happening of my entire life.
You went out to Mali, Frankie. Ain't no lie. Enough to make a wild-eyed maverick like myself want to settle down someday.
Oh, don't say that unless you really mean it.
It's time for me to put my rumbling and my rocking behind me. Even a cowboy like me has to hang up his spurs.
Oh, Johnny, if you say what I think you're gonna say, you're gonna make me the happiest dame in all of Dublin City.
Well, pucker up, Buttercup, because I want you to join me in sweet and holy matrimony.
Just window dressing.
I won't kill you. shows up, they can trace me. But once I keep you alive, there'll be no archaeological evidence, and I can roam free.
Oh, can't swallow. They'll trace me back here in seconds.
Funny that. It seems awfully quiet to me.
All I'm saying is, as partners, we should respect each other's opinions and concerns.
Fine! Respecty-wecty, love fest. Anything that shuts you up.
You see, now that is exactly what I'm talking about.
Shh! I think I see something.
What is it?
Brown.
Shape?
I'm gonna go with monk-shaped.
Right. Well, Bob said that Alex traced a tome back here at the monastery, and there's word of it mentioned in the manuscript of St. Edel.
Let's roll.
Sorry, brother. We're looking for a foreign traveller. A man of unusual garb and tongue.
Dost thou know him?
Oh, yes.
We know him very well indeed. Work, you know. It was me who built it. You never undo what I've done.
It's nothing to do with us, Professor Lee. We're just here to take you home.
You're just pawns. You're serving political ends you don't even know about. Let me go and I'll show you'll never hear from me again.
Look, we've already got two of you in a cage in the facility. Just come back with us and we can sort this whole mess out.
Sort it out? It's all meaningless. It doesn't mean anything. It doesn't matter what I do. It doesn't matter what you do. We're all just crap scraped off on a rock. A turd floating through space waiting to die. Well, I'm not waiting any longer.
No!
I don't buy it. I bet you he jumped just in time.
I don't know. I can see a body. I think it's his.
Really?
I think it is.
Great. In that case, job done. Now let's go home and have a nice cold shower.
Okay. Oh, wait. We've got one more thing to do.
Oh, for God's sake!
Hey, what's going on?
I'm so sorry, Joe. I never thought...
What's this, the time cops?
I thought we were just chatting. I never meant to hurt you.
Hurt me? I'm grand.
I'm so sorry. Something's happened. Something's led them to you. Something I've done has led them to you. I'm so terribly sorry.
What are you talking about?
Come on, it's time to go.
Look, it's probably best if you just forget you ever met him.
Where are you taking him?
No!
No, no. It wasn't me, it was the time travelers. Oh, you're having a laugh.